श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरि ओम। ओम पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीं अम्बत्वामनुसन्ददामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणी। नमोऽस्तु ते व्यास विशालबुद्धे पुल्लारविन्दायतपत्रमित्र येन त्वया भारततैलपूर्णः प्रज्वालितो ज्ञानमयप्रदीपः प्रपन्नपारिजाताय स्तोत्रवेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः। वसुते वसुतं देवं कंसचानूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानन्दं कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुं। भीष्मद्रोणतटाजयद्रथजला गान्धारनीलोत्पला शल्यग्राहवती कृपेण वहनी कर्णेन वेलाकुला अश्वत्थामिविकर्णघोरमकरा दुर्योधनावर्तिनी सोत्तीर्णा खलु पाण्डवैरणनदी कैवर्तककेशवः पाराशर्यवचः सरोजममलं गीतार्थगन्धोत्कटं नानाख्यानककेसरं हरिकथा सम्बोधनाबोधितं लोके सज्जनषट्पदैरहरहः पेपीयमानं मुदा भूयाद्भारतपङ्कजं कलिमलप्रध्वंसि न श्रेयसे। मूकं करोति वाचालं पङ्गुं लङ्घयते कृ यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे परमानन्दमाधवं यं ब्रह्मावरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगा ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनः यस्यान्तं न विदुःसुरासुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः देवाय तस्मै नमः। विल गो टू वर्स नंबर 55 55 फाइव फाइव। आई होप यू कैन हियर मी बिकॉज एवरीवन इज लुकिंग कंफ्यूज्ड। कैन यू हियर मी? ओके सो वर्स नंबर 55 श्री भगवानुवाच प्रजहाति यदा कामान् सर्वान् पार्थ मनोगतान् आत्मन्येवात्मना तुष्टः स्थित प्रज्ञस्तदोच्यते दुःखेष्वनुद्विग्नमनाः सुखेषु विगतस्पृहः वीतरागभयक्रोधः स्थितधीर्मुनिरुच्यते यः सर्वत्रानभिस्नेहः तत्तत्प्राप्य शुभाशुभं नाभिनन्दन्ति न द्वेष्टि तस्य प्रज्ञा प्रतिष्ठिता यदा संहरते चायं कूर्मोऽङ्गानीव सर्वशः इन्द्रियाणीन्द्रियार्थेभ्यः तस्य प्रज्ञा प्रतिष्ठिता विषया विनिवर्तन्ते निराहारस्य देहिनः रसवर्जम रसोप्यस्य परम दृष्ट्वा निवर्तते. वर्स नंबर 60. यततो ह्यपि कौन्तेय पुरुषस्य विपश्चितः इन्द्रियाणि प्रमाथीनि हरन्ति प्रसभं मनः तानि सर्वाणि संयम्य युक्त आसीत मत्परः वशे हि यस्येन्द्रियाणि तस्य प्रज्ञा प्रतिष्ठिता ध्यायतो विषयान् पुंसः संगस्तेषु उपजायते संगात् संजायते कामः कामात् क्रोधो विजायते क्रोधात् भवति सम्मोहः सम्मोहात् स्मृति विभ्रमः स्मृतिभ्रंशात् बुद्धिनाशः बुद्धिनाशात् प्रणश्यति रागद्वेषवियुक्तैस्तु विषयानिन्द्रियैश्चरन् आत्मवश्येर्विधेयात्मा प्रसादम् अधिगच्छति प्रसादे सर्वदुःखानां हानेरस्योपजायते प्रसन्नचेतसो ह्याशुः बुद्धि पर्यवतिष्ठते नास्ति बुद्धिरयुक्तस्य न चायुक्तस्य भावना न चाभावयतः शान्तिः अशान्तस्य कुतः सुखम्. ओके, वेलकम टू ऑल ऑफ यू. वेलकम. Okay, so we meet for Bhagavad Gita after many, many days. Okay, so we'll have a brief summary and then we'll go ahead. Okay, let me do all this, put this aside. Okay. So, Arjuna, he wanted to know about the characteristics of a Sthita Prajna. Who is a Sthita Prajna? One whose prajnaha isthitaha means one who has totally assimilated this knowledge of the self. Okay, self-knowledge is totally assimilated. Okay, so Lord Krishna is answering Arjuna's questions and he divides the topic into two parts. First is that what are the sthita prajna lakshanani, means what are the characteristics, the natural traits of the sthita prajna. And basically, Krishna pointed out that the Sthita Prajna, the one who has recognized himself, okay? How has he recognized himself? That I am Satchidananda. That I am the consciousness that is ever present, that is indestructible, that is indivisible, okay? That is Purna. Iti, that person has recognized. When that person has recognized this about himself, then what happens with that person? He is happy with himself, right? He does not depend upon any external conditions for his happiness. So he has got samatvam. He has got equanimity in all the situations. And we saw vita raga bhaya krodhaha. He is free from raga, attachment, bhaya, fear, from krodha, anger, etc. Meaning all the negative emotions which trouble us a lot. That kind of stuff, this sthita prajna is free of. So Krishna pointed out that these are the natural, spontaneously, you know, the spontaneous traits of a sthita prajna. And whatever is spontaneous trait of the sthita prajna becomes sadhana for us. Iti. So then, Krishna begins to start pointing out what are the sadhanas, okay, the disciplines which are required for a person to become a sthita prajna. First job is what? He has to become a prajna. Who is a prajna? A prajna is one who has received this knowledge of the self. Means Bhagavad Gita suna hai, Upanishad suna hai. He has received the knowledge of the self. And self-knowledge, how can it be received? In Vedanta, in our traditional Vedanta Shastra, we say there is only, you know, one way of receiving the self-knowledge, and that is by listening to the Shastra. Through a competent teacher, you have to listen. And that's the only way you're going to get this self-knowledge. So it is called a Shravana. Then that self-knowledge which you receive from your teacher, okay, that Shravana Janya knowledge has to become free of all doubts. You have to free, because knowledge with doubts is as good as no knowledge at all. Remember, I used to tell you, ke samjo, you know, I have to go to Delhi and I ring up somebody and ask them, you know, what time is that train? And that person tells me, maybe it's at 3 o'clock, maybe it's at 4 o'clock. Hey, that is doubtful knowledge. It's as good as no knowledge, right? So the knowledge which is received in Shravana has to be made free of doubts. And that process is called as Manana. Okay. All the doubts have to be eliminated. Okay. You know, this Vedanta, the knowledge given in Vedanta, it's not a belief system. Right? And therefore, doubts can be there. It's about knowledge. And so there must be a conviction about it. Okay. So one removes the doubts either by one's own reflecting, uske bare mein soch soch ke, yeah, you have questions and you ask the teacher. Arjuna himself had many questions which he asks Lord Krishna. So, and this process is called as Mananam. So, Shravanam and Mananam, it makes me a Prajnaha, right? The one who has received this knowledge, okay? And the received knowledge is doubt-free, okay? But Krishna wants to point out that this doubt-free knowledge, or, you know, this doubt-free knowledge is not enough, because it will remain only in the intellect. But the life situations that we face in life, they are all faced by whom? They are faced by the emotional personality. There is an emotional personality in each one of us. And, you know, that person is going to face the life situations. And therefore, Krishna points out that something more is required, right? All of us know, you know, that worry is not useful. And everybody knows that, you know, worry is not going to change the situation. And even though I know that I should not worry, but I'm not able to avoid my worry. I'm not able to avoid anxiety. So when we get this knowledge, intellectually we may be satisfied. So the intellect is telling me something, but the mind quietly does something else. So therefore a transformation is required, right? There has to be a transformation in the intellectual personality, which happens by Shravanam and Mananam, but it is not enough. There is requirement for transformation of the emotional personality also. So transformation at intellectual level, we call it as cognitive change. Cognitive change definitely has to take place. It is very much required. But the knowledge has to be converted to emotional strength, so that different situations are going to come in my life. And with reference to them, I can remain as a balanced person, iti. If you look at this attachment, meaning emotional dependence, it's an emotional issue. Jealousy, emotional issue. Anger, emotional issue. Fear, emotional issue. Hurt, emotional issue. Guilt, emotional issue. Now, all these are emotional problems, iti. Insecurity. Even great intellectuals face this. You may have a great intellect. You might be, you know, pura philosophy padhai, sab kuch padhai, but you may have a lot of sense of insecurity. Therefore, it's not only intellectual transformation which is required. We need to bring about the necessary emotional transformation, and it is that transformation which will help to convert this prajnaha, this knowledge which is received, okay, into my own strength, okay, and it will be converted from prajnaha to stita prajnaha. So in talking about how to transfer this prajna into stita prajna, Lord Krishna discusses some aspects of what is required, what are the disciplines required. So from verse 58 onwards, some of the sadhanas are going to be discussed. Okay. So it's very important to understand that we convert our Gita study to emotional strength. So once we get the knowledge, not that we stop attending the classes. Yes, intellectual change takes place. What happens when you study the Gita? You begin to know, yes, I'm not the body. You begin to know what is body. You begin to know what is mind. Who am I with reference to them? Who am I without reference to them? Iti, all this becomes very clear. What is Atma? What is our world? Who is Ishvara? All this becomes clear in the intellect, but that knowledge should give me strength. So Krishna is going to give us three sadhanas. Okay. So to become a stita prajna, Krishna gives us these upayas or these sadhanas. What are they? First, which we saw, because we are still in the summary, is damaha. Damaha means mastery over one's senses. Means the five senses that we have, right? Shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha. We have, these are the objects which come into us. And over them we use our eyes, The eyes, nose, ears, touch, right? Taste. All of these senses. Because what happens through them, the world enters our mind. Okay. So the world can enter our mind without our permission. See, when we build a house, what happens? When we build a house, we don't let anybody to enter it, no? We build a house, it's got a nice door. Here's the door. There's a door. There's one more door. So we don't allow anybody to enter it. We close the door. Everybody is not allowed to enter our house. And even the windows, robbers can enter. So we put bars over there. Sometimes we have to close the windows. If there is a very strong wind, etc., we don't want that wind to come. It's very cold now. We close the windows. So we don't allow everything and anything to come in. In fact, we have in our head at least, or we have a board which will say, no admission without permission, right? No admission without permission. So similarly, even with reference to our mind, we need to have that board. No admission without my conscious permission, iti. So any and every form should not be allowed to enter inside. Swami Chinmayananji used to say nicely, otherwise what is going to happen? Your mind is going to be like a public toilet. Because in a public toilet, anybody and everybody enters over there. And then it leaves a stink behind. So different types of, things can enter into your mind. And so we don't want that. So through the sense organs, all types of rubbish can enter. And what happens is, especially when you're sensitive, is some pictures remain behind in the mind and you get occupied with it. If it comes into your mind and you can let go of it, no problem. But we are not able to let go, we get occupied with it and usi ke upar hum, hamari buddhi usi ke upar chalta rehta hai. So, this kind of dhamma is very, very important. At least until there is a great deal of mastery. Until there is jnana nishta, I would say. Until that kind of nishta occurs, dhamma is important. Now, what happens in spite of all the sense control that we do? हम लोग ने बहुत किया सेंस कंट्रोल, फिर भी समथिंग और द अदर इज नेचुरली गोइंग टू एंटर. किसी बात कर रहे थे, हमने सुन लिया, और समबडी कम्स एंड टेल्स मी समथिंग, आई हर्ड इट. इथी सो इन डिफरेंट वे समथिंग और द अदर इज गोइंग टू एंटर आवर माइंड. नॉट दैट आई वॉन्ट टू हियर इट, बट आई कॉन्ट प्लग माई इयर्स. इथी सो डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ फॉर्म्स डू एंटर. वी आर वॉकिंग ऑन द रोड, समथिंग और द अदर कम्स. सो वंस द वर्ल्ड हैज एंटर्ड, व्हाट टू डू? So now it is up to me. The world has entered inside. What should I do? I can choose. It is my choice not to be controlled by that. Okay? So let my choice be there, that I am able to let it go. I don't allow it to control me. Do I have to relive the conversation? Or if something, you know, some rubbish or the other happened, do I have to replay it again and again in my mind? Iti. Or a particular picture came into my mind. Do I have to go over it again and again? So a particular thought coming into my mind, and I don't have control because thought just happens. Maybe some Purva Janma Samskar also, thought happens. So don't try to stop thought. Thought can happen and it does happen. Okay? But subscribing to the thought and going after it, that can be in our own hands. Okay, so sometimes things come up from the subconscious, but we can use our own buddhi for it. So we use our willpower to nip that thought as it takes place. And this discipline, it's a discipline, it's a training. This discipline is for the mind, and it is called as shamaha. Okay, and so under shama we can put lot of things. Just now we learnt EFT.
You can yahan par bhi hoga isme graphic era wagera mein law fact hai usme chale jao.
Who is making noise? Okay, let me Sneha, not Sneha, one minute, let me mute everybody. Nalini, but I can't mute her. Okay, I'm not able to see who is there. Okay, never mind. Okay, so now we learnt about this EFT, right? So EFT will come under what? It will come under shamaha. Psychotherapy, any form of therapy you may have, anything which helps for mastery of our mind. Okay, our breathing exercises, because they make the mind calm. Yoga asana, it makes the mind calm. Iti japa, prayers, values, attitudes, all of this is, you know, then what happens as you go deeper and deeper into spiritual sadhana? Sometimes when you're doing japa or when you're meditating, many people complain, I'm not able to meditate. Mujhse meditation nahi hota hai. Because the mind is restless. It's disturbed. It's got into the habit of being restless. Or people, they may be meditating, but then something comes up from the deep unconscious and they get frightened. Iti. Fright is a very common thing which happens in meditation. People get scared, so they can't go deeper into meditation, I think. So that is the subconscious. Subconscious mein se jo bhi suppressed fear tha, suppressed dukh tha, jo bhi tha, wo sab bahar aane lagti hai. Okay? So all this, how to handle the subconscious, that is called as kashaya. And this handling subconscious kashaya is very important because it will even help physical health. Because many things stay in the subconscious and affect our health. This is proven, you know. Should listen to Deepak Chopra. He talks about cellular healing. Iti. And it's all to do with the emotional, this thing. Suppressed feelings, things which are in the unconscious, they will affect our health for sure, 100%. So learning to process the kashaya, and as you get deeper and deeper into spiritual life, kashaya will come up. And one must learn how to handle it. Iti. But all this comes under what? All this comes under the topic of Shama. Okay. Now, then Krishna talks about one more thing, and he says these two are not enough. Shama and Dhanama are not enough. There is a third discipline which is very important, and that is dwelling on the teaching. We have received to dwell upon it. So, you dwell on the teaching which you received during Shravana. How are you going to dwell on the teaching? You can read, you can revise. Therefore, taking notes is important. So, you can revise. Nowadays, what happens? Now, I will put this on Zoom. So, whole class is available for you. You can revise. And generally, we advise revise either the same day or the next day. Because then it stays fresh. So, when you revise, you know, it stays fresh in your mind. And it helps in assimilation. Because Nididhyasana is about assimilation of the knowledge. So that it comes and it helps you and it is there as strength for you in your daily life, Iti. So revision is very important. At least before class coming, revising is a good thing to do. Other thing is you could be writing. You know, the very process of writing is Nididhyasana. You're listening to the class and you're writing. Or you have a blog and you listened to class or you read something and you were thinking about it or you were meditating and some thoughts, insights came in your mind and you wrote about it. That's how I keep a blog, you know. Because when I meditate, something comes and then I write about it. It's some insights I get and then you put it on the blog. It is as good as Nididhyasana Iti. Or you formally sit down for Vedantic meditation. The kind of meditation which I give you on guided meditations in Facebook of Swami Viditatmananji, that is called as Vedantic meditation. And that is all something which helps in assimilating this knowledge. It is very important. And once I do this assimilation, what happens? It brings about a transformation, right? So, students of Gita, you know, they report, I've written it down on the slide, that I may not be able to claim that I am a Jnani. I may not be able to claim that I am a Jivan Mukta. I may not be able to claim that I am a Sthita Prajna. But I can say that previously for small incidents, I used to worry for days together. And now for big incidents, I worry for just a few hours or just, you know, for a day only at the most, Iti. So this kind of study, the satsang, helps to strengthen the mind. Okay, it helps them. So this was called as Nididhyasanam, assimilating the knowledge by dwelling on the teaching. Okay, and now in the next verse, Krishna emphasizes on Dhammaha. Ragadvesha viyuktaistu vishinyan indriyaischaran atmavashyer vidhiyatma prasadam adigachati. Says, but tu vishinyan charan, moving amongst these sense objects, you know, because you the objects which you can't avoid. You're walking on the road and you're going to see some posters. You're walking on the road, you will hear something or the other. So it's unavoidable, sense objects. With sense organs under his control, indriyehi atmavashyehi iti, and which are free from likes and dislikes, the self-controlled one, videyatma, the self-controlled one, he enjoys tranquility. That means when you allow the sense organs to move in the world, let it be like a very cautious driver. You know, a cautious driver, he can increase the speed. He can go 30, 40, 50, 60, 70. But he is a cautious driver. There's a difference between a cautious driver and a rash driver. A rash driver, he will increase the speed, but then he loses control over the vehicle, right? And so he can get into accidents. Whereas the cautious driver, he can go faster, but any moment he will be able to put the brake or change the course of the weaker. He is able to do that. So similarly, remember that our body is a vehicle. You know, it is our car. Like, that's why I put the picture of this car, you know. It is our car, iti. And our sense organs are like the wheels on the vehicle. Right? Because the sense organs are going to drive on the road, which has got all the objects on it. So it's like the wheels. Okay. And the mind is the steering. And you are the driver who is using this, who is handling the steering. Iti. This example is actually given in Kathopanishad. Iti. So your body is the car. The sense organs are the wheels. So maintain, you know, control over the sense organs, over the wheels of the sense organs. Maintain control over the steering. Don't let it go out of your control, iti. Maintain control over your body, the car, body car. So if this person is able to lead a disciplined life like this, then what happens? Prasadam adigachati. Okay? He attains tranquility. He becomes peaceful, iti. He is able to maintain equanimity. His mind is free from up and down yo-yo of emotions. There is more and more samatvam for him, iti. So the, you know, so the what is the advantages of Dhamma and also of Shama? FIR reduces. What is FIR? I wrote it down so that no one forgets. F is what? Frequency of mental disturbances. I is intensity. And R is the recovery period. Right? So, frequency of mental disturbances reduces, intensity reduces, and you recover very quickly. Okay? The recovery period also reduces. Iti. Then in the next verse, prasade sarva dukkhanam hanihi asyopajayate prasannate cha sohyashu buddhif paryavatishtate. Prasade, when the mind is tranquil, what happens? Some benefits are there. The advantage of having samatvam. Prasade means when there is samatvam, when there is an equanimous mind, when there is samatvam, when there is poise, when there is balance. Okay? So then there are some advantages. Krishna talks about twofold advantages. The first one is sarva dukkha naam hanihi. There is destruction of all sorrows. Meaning, this samatvam, when it is there, sorrow is not there. Samatvam brings in happiness or joy. Okay. This is a very interesting slide. Eh? Now, what to do with all this? Eh? Okay. So, what is being said here is that in Vedanta, we say that you don't have to bring in happiness from the external, from the outside world, because the outside world does not have any happiness to give to me. Happiness is not an object which is lying there in the outside world. To give me happiness, you know, happiness is an object. And if I get that object, then I'm going to get happiness, iti. That is not true. The outside world does not give any happiness to me. So outside world cannot give happiness because it doesn't have happiness in it. Iti. We'll look at this. Okay? And then Vedanta says, in fact, the outside world need not give happiness. Why? Because I am the source of happiness. The source of happiness is oneself alone, iti. Let's look at this. You know, I put this thing called dog logic here. Okay. When the dog, you know, this is a Shastra example. When a dog bites a bone, right? When the dog is biting the bone, it's an old bone. You know, it's an old bone. It was there under the mud. This dog took it out from the mud and he's chewing on it. And unko bada anand aa raha hai. That bone does not have any blood in it. But what happens is when he has broken the bone, there are sharp pieces there. And those sharp pieces have hurt his tongue. And therefore, you know, blood is coming from his own tongue. But he thinks, you know, that the blood is coming from the bone. And so he looks upon the bone, you know, as the source of blood. So what is the dog logic? Before biting the bone, there was no blood. After biting the bone, there is blood. Therefore, bone is the source of blood. This is the dog's logic. It's a funny logic, Iti. We can call it as dog logic. And what does Vedanta say? That we are not very much better off. What is human logic, you know? We think that before using the sense object, there was no happiness. Now, after using the sense objects, after eating the gulab jamun, after doing this, or after eating the ice cream, or after whatever, there is happiness. Therefore, we think that sense objects are the source of happiness, Iti. Vedanta says that every object is like that bone. It does not have even a droplet of joy in it. But sense objects, they are only responsible in bringing out the happiness, which is our own happiness. How does that happen? You know, because, you know, that's, I've discussed this many times with you all, that sense of apurnata is there. I'm wanting, I want, I lack. And because that sense is there, I want to feel, you know, purna. So I project the purnatvam on some object or the other and then I hanker for it. I say, no, that is going to make me happy. That is going to make me happy. This is going to make me happy. And then I go after that. So there's a hankering in the mind. There's a craving, you know, for the object. There's a craving for happiness. Craving for the object. That craving keeps me away from, there's so much of mental disturbance there that it keeps me away from the happiness which is my own nature, Iti. So these mental disturbances, this restlessness which is there, keeps me away. So Vedanta says that when I acquire the sense object, it only removes, you know, it's like a layer is there over the happiness which is myself, which is the craving that I have. It's as though covering my own natural happiness. And when that sense object is acquired, that craving subsides for the time being. That restlessness subsides for the time being. And then the happiness, which is my own nature, which is already there, hamesha hai, it just spills forth. You know, it is expressed, that purnatvam expresses as happiness in the mind, Iti. So when there are mental disturbances blocking our happiness, and so when we have this kind of mastery over our sense organs, mastery over our mind, then the mental disturbances are more or less removed, the blocks are removed, and then what happens? Atmananda manifests. Therefore, Krishna is saying, prasade sarva dukkha naam hanihi. All the dukkha is destroyed, hanihi bhavati iti. Okay, and the person enjoys this ananda. That is the first benefit. Sarva dukkana hanihi. Okay, the second benefit is asya prasanna chetasaha buddhihi paryavatishtate. For this prasanna chetasaha, calm minded person, for whom now, you know, there is shamaha, there is samatvam. For that person, buddhihi, the self-knowledge, this jnanaha, becomes well-rooted well assimilated, the prajnyah becomes sthita prajnyah. Okay, the knowledge becomes well assimilated. So you should remember that the amount of food that I consume is not so important. It's the amount of food that I assimilate that is important, right? So what happens? People, they start studying Vedanta and they'll say, I finished studying this Upanishad. I studied that Upanishad. I studied the third and fourth and fifth and sixth. And I studied the Gita also. And I did the Brahma Sutras also. And I did this, you know, I did this particular Prakarana Grantha and I did that particular Prakarana Grantha. Okay, the amount of food you ate is a lot. But what did you assimilate? Iti. So it's the assimilated food, the assimilated knowledge, which is important. And for that purpose, the Shama Dhamma is very much important. Okay, assimilation helps to calm. So there is sort of it looks like there is a circle here. When you assimilate a little bit of knowledge, the mind becomes calm. When the mind becomes calm, a little more knowledge is assimilated. When the little more knowledge is assimilated, again the mind becomes calmer. And when the mind becomes calmer, a little more knowledge is assimilated. And there is this beautiful exponential assimilation of the knowledge when we take care of Dhamma and Shama, both. Okay? Okay. And then that means what? The knowledge becomes available for me in my day-to-day life. Okay. Now he is going to do a little bit of Ninda. Okay. In the next verse, Nasti buddhihi ayuktasya. Nacha yuktasya bhavana. Nacha bhavayata shantihi. Ashantasya kutasukam. So, buddhihi nasti. The self-knowledge, this assimilated knowledge does not arise for whom? Ayuktasya. For the person who is not disciplined. Bhavana chana. Ayuktasya. Meaning, for this person who is not disciplined, even contemplation becomes very difficult. He is not able to contemplate. And if he is not able to contemplate, nacha shanti abhavayataha. The person who can't contemplate, where is he going to have shanti from? Iti. Kuta sukham ashantasya. And if there's no shanti, where can there be sukham for this person? How will this person be a happy person, Iti? How can there be sukham? So Krishna is again highlighting Shama and Dhamma. Okay, in this verse again, you can imagine that he is constantly highlighting this. Now, I think all of you remember now that Shravanam. Shravanam means listening to the scriptures. Okay. Now you tell me, for listening to the scriptures, don't you need this kind of Shama Dhamma? Otherwise, you come for the class, but your mind is all over. You know? Even in the Zoom class, you come into the Zoom class, and in the Zoom class, your mind is all over. Iti. Or supposing we were actually having a class, you may be very much present in the class, but your mind could be all over the place. So you don't hear what happened, you know. You miss whatever happened, Iti. So Shama Dhamma is very much required even for Shravanam itself. You know, one Swamiji was telling us a story that one lady who was coming very regularly to his class, one day she comes with a safety pin and she comes and gives it to the Swamiji. So Swamiji asked her that, what do you mean? You know, like, why are you giving me a safety pin? It is. Let me just put this on, you know, my other phone on. Yeah. So why are you giving me this safety pin? So she says, oh Swamiji, you know, so many times you're adjusting your Angavastram. So I thought if I give you a safety pin, then you can pin your Angavastram down. So the Swamiji is thinking to himself, my God, she never heard anything. All the time she's doing is looking at me, adjusting my Angavastram. You know, so this is the way you need both Shama and Dhamma. Then, okay. So, okay, just one sec, okay. I just lost my page. Okay, now comes something interesting. You know, in Ramayanam, Pooja Swamiji used to say this. No offense meant, it's just a little joke. For Gita, what happens? The logic is very tight. So you have to listen. If you miss something, then you miss a lot. But in Ramayanam, what happens? 14 years Rama is in the forest. So, you know, you may go to sleep. Beech mein Ramayan mein so bhi jate hain. So you go to sleep. When you get up, he's still in the forest, you know. So it doesn't matter if you go to sleep in Ramayan class, in Ramayan satsang. But in Gita satsang, you can't afford to do that, you know, because the logic is tightly developed between one verse and the other verse. And there is a logic constantly that is being developed all the time. Iti, so you require an attentive mind. Okay. So Swami Chinmayananji used to talk about the qualities of a student. Who is the student? He is the one who has kaka drishtihi. Means he has got the observation of a crow. You know, the crow is able to look all around and he's very one-pointed. You remember that story of the crow? You know, he's also very intelligent. You know, there is this pot and there are stones, you know, something of his has dropped inside, and then, you know, he can't put his beak inside and there is water there. So he begins to put in stones and slowly the water level comes up. And he is able to get what he wants. So you have to be like the crow, you know. You have to be, you have the observation of a crow and the, you know, what do you say? You are together like a crow, you know, you know how to use your resources, etc. Baka dhyanam, the attention of a stork. You know, we have watched a stork, you know, like if there is flowing water, even in Rishikesh, you can see, you know, outside our ashram. There's flowing water there and there is this stalk and it, you know, there is fish going in that water. So it has just got one pointed attention. It's looking at the fish and how easily it's able to pick up the fish. Just look, it's moving water and the fish is moving with it. But this guy's concentration is such that he just picks up that fish. No effort. It looks effortless to us. It's because of his concentration. Okay. Then, Bakadhyanam, Shwana Nidra, sleeps like a dog. Meaning, you know, the dog always has his one eye open. He doesn't sleep. Especially stray dogs. Apna ghar ka kutta to achi tarah se sota hoga. But stray dogs, they have to always be alert. You know, they don't, it is to show the alertness. Even when sleeping, this person is alert. Iti. Okay. And then, Alpaharam. Little bit of food. Because if you eat too much food, then what will happen? You go to sleep. Then Jirna Vastram. Not you know, relevant to you all. But meaning you're not on a fashion parade. You know, otherwise all your attention is on your clothes. You know, you go to class and you know, everybody in the class is wanting a fashion parade. You know, she was wearing this and she was wearing that. And, you know, that kind of stuff is not there. It is simple living. It's indicative of simple living. So all this is indicative of a student. For a student, these are all the qualities which are very important. Okay. So Krishna is telling that before listening, you require Shamadama. Then for Mananam, for reflecting, you require Shamadana. And even for Nididhyasana, you require Shamadama. And without that, this spiritual progress is not possible. Okay? In fact, I would say not possible. I would say, let's not say, you know, be so extreme. I'll say it's very difficult. Be extremely difficult. Okay? So now, okay. Oh, wow. We have done 49 minutes and it's still allowing me. How come? Okay. So, it will go any moment. So now, so the person who has got this kind of sense control, okay, and who has got Shama and Dhamma, that person is called as a Yuktaha. This person is together. He is a Yuktaha, iti meaning a person who has both Shama and Dhamma. So ayukta means what? The person who doesn't have shama or dama. Okay. So ayuktasya buddhihi nasti. This guy is not going to have this kind of assimilation of the knowledge. Shravana manana is not possible. Far less nididhyasanam. Assimilation is possible for that guy. So that means he cannot, even prajna is not possible. He cannot even receive the knowledge, far less he can assimilate that knowledge. Okay. Okay. So here the word bhavana means nididhyasanam, contemplation. Okay, bhavana cha na means contemplation is also Vedantic meditation also will not be possible for this guy. And we are not going to elaborate on what is Vedanta meditation. Chidananda rupaha shivoham shivoham. That is Vedantic meditation. Okay. Okay. Even that will not be possible for that person. Okay. So if a person does not practice this Shravana Manana Nididhyasana, then what will be the consequence? Shantihi nasti. Abhavayataha shantihi nasti. There will be no peace of mind for that person. So remember, Gita study is not an academic pursuit. You know, it's not like college, just an academic pursuit. Gita study means transformation. There is a transformation in the intellect. There's a transformation in the emotional personality. That effort, the transformation in the emotional personality requires effort. It doesn't happen by itself. Okay? So there's a transformation in the way I look at life, in the way I look at the world, in the way I look at myself. Okay? There's that kind of transformation. And that transformation, what happens? It brings peace of mind. So Gita study, it looks like it's academic, but the benefits are totally practical for us. And what is the practical benefit? Shantihi. You know? You live very consciously, you're living in the present. Your mind is not occupied with the past. It's not occupied with the future. You're right here. And when you're right here, that's why I keep telling you, do this meditation of being right here. You will experience a shanti. There is a shanti in the background. There's a stillness, a shanti in the background, and that shanti is yourself. My today's blog has got something about it. Okay? Okay, so let's look at the next slide. Ashantasya kutas sukham iti. Without peace of mind, where is the question of Atma Ananda? Atma is Ananda, but where is the question of that Ananda manifesting when the mind is troubled iti? Because Atma Ananda can only come in a very, very calm mind. Okay, when if it's okay. Only in a calm mind it can reflect. Okay. If you want to see your reflection in a mirror, if the mirror is very dirty, can it reflect you as you are? If the mirror is moving up and down, you know, will you be able to see your face in it? No. The mirror will have to be stationary and it will have to be clean. Similarly, our mind is the mirror. Okay. And this Atma Ananda can be reflected only in the mind which is undisturbed, which is calm. So if the mind is going to be disturbed, Krishna says, Ashantasya kutas sukham. How can this Atma Ananda be reflected in that mind? Iti. Okay. This example is a Shastric example. So there will be never be, even if we use any other method, you know, pranayam karo, kuch na kuch karo. But you don't get permanent sukham. You get only temporary. There is only temporary. Other than knowledge, any other method that we adopt is only temporary. Iti. Some people will say, you know, I went to the ashram and that saint was there. And what vibrations. My mind, I enjoyed such shanti. I enjoyed such shanti. Hey, look at the word enjoyed. Enjoyed. What is it? Which tense is it? Past tense. Okay. So the enjoyment was past and now the person is tense. Iti. So the ananda that got past and now I'm feeling tense. So any other method that we use will be a temporary method. Whereas Atmajnanam, Shastra says, Tesam Shantihi Shashvati. You get permanent sukham with Atmajnanam. In the assimilated, when it is assimilated, na itarisha iti. So with that, we conclude today's, and I am in a state of shock because 55 minutes have passed and Zoom has not stopped it. Kya hua? I don't know. It's some grace of God. Eh? Some God's grace only. Okay. So we conclude with that and we will meet at 7:30 for Hanuman Chalisa. Okay. Okay. Om Swasti Prajabhya Paripalayantam Nyayena Margena Mahim Mahishaha Go Brahmanebhya Shubhamastu Nityam Loka Samasta Sukhino Bhavantu Kale Varshatu Parjanyaha Prithvi Sasya Shalini Desho Yam Shobharahitah Brahmana Santu Nirbhayaha Om Sarve Sham Swastir Bhavatu Sarve Sham Shantir Bhavatu Sarve Sham Purnam Bhavatu Sarve Sham Mangalam Bhavatu Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinaha Sarve Santu Niramayaha Sarve Badrani Pashyantu Makaschid Dukkha Bhag Bhavet Asatuma Sadgamaya Tamasuma Jyotir Gamaya Mrityorma Amritam Gamaya
Mrityorma Amrit Gamaya
Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om Om Tat Sat. Okay, see you all at 7:30. Okay, oh, I'll send the invitation now. Oh, my,